up nutrition movement, and of course the Assistant Secretary General to the United Nations. Gives me great pleasure to welcome on stage here in Brussels, ladies and gentlemen, Gerda Verburg. Gerda, welcome. I'm very impressed with the way our guests, they don't bother with the steps, they're just straight up on the stage. Well done. Welcome, Gerda.
Good morning, Your Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to set the scene for today's discussions at the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition International Forum, although the speakers before me were hitting the nail on the head as well. Thank you for being so straightforward. But let me also be clear from the outset. Gone are the days of dividing our narratives, interests, and sectors. Today, and for every day after today, we are compelled by the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development to tackle the interconnected issues of food security, nutrition, and sustainable agriculture in unison, which will contribute to unlocking progress across all the Sustainable Development Goals. The start of the Agenda 2030 coincided with the launch of the United Nations Decade of Action on Nutrition, 2016-2025, adding impetus to joint efforts at eradicating hunger and preventing all forms of malnutrition worldwide. The initiative that I coordinate, the Scaling Up Nutrition Movement, you noticed, is driven by 60 member countries and 3 Indian states, all demonstrating that concerted action, multisectoral and multi-stakeholder collaboration is the only path to eliminating hunger and malnutrition by 2030. To achieve this ambition, looking at agriculture, food, and health separately must become history. Instead, a focus on sustainable and healthy food systems, as was also already pleaded for by Barbara, so a focus on healthy, sustainable food systems will be fundamental. Current global and local food systems are not delivering healthy food to a third of the world's population, currently suffering from one of several forms of malnutrition. Food systems need to be dramatically rethought and transformed if they are to contribute fully to the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And all stakeholders, everyone in this room has a role to play. As will be discussed, the review of the Common Agricultural Policy, the CAP, and development cooperation should contribute towards such transformation. Today, I would like to share some challenges and opportunities for you all to take this momentum for action and translate it into impact and results for people everywhere who suffer from malnutrition. This will need us to leave, indeed, our logos and egos at the door and reassess how we partner, how we collaborate, and how we build on what exists already in every country. So no more standalone initiatives, build upon what is already there. Increasingly, nutrition and food security are recognized as a maker and marker for sustainable development, and the linchpin that can help drive success across the SDGs. The first 1,000 days from a mother's pregnancy to her child's second birthday is a pivotal window of opportunity that determines a child's future. Good nutrition builds strong immune systems and cognitive infrastructure, supercharging children's chances of survival and protecting them their whole lives. It's also critical for adolescent girls and mothers before pregnancy, as their good health is critical to ensuring children get the best start in life, halting the vicious intergenerational cycle of malnutrition and poverty. Today, nutrition is seen as a crucial determinant of human capital and therefore of economic prosperity. In every Sun Movement country I visit, when I share the effects that stunting has on cognitive development, the brain development, and the ripple effect it has on a person's education, their capacity to work, the lifelong impact on their health, and therefore the knock-on effects for societies, economies, and even peace and prosperity, the response is acute. Policymakers feel motivated to act, realizing that investing in human capital is the smartest approach towards social and economic development and stability. Despite this recognition, world hunger is on the rise again. Much of the recent increase in food insecurity can be traced to a greater number of conflicts, often exacerbated by climate-related shocks. Even in some peaceful settings, food security has deteriorated as economic slowdowns challenges access to food for the poor. This worrying trend is not yet reflected in levels of stunting, which continue to fall, but it is crucial to ring the political alarm. Our narrative needs to connect food security, nutrition, to unlocking progress across all sustainable Our narrative needs to connect food security, nutrition, and sustainable agriculture in unison, a food systems approach which will contribute to unlocking progress across all sustainable development goals. And although countries are striving to keep these issues high on their political agenda, approximately 3 billion people from every one of the world's 193 countries have low quality diets, causing devastating undernutrition, obesity, non-communicable diseases, creating health problems. Over the next 20 years, multiple forms of malnutrition will pose increasingly serious threats to global health. Today, one third of all produced food is either lost around production or wasted by us as consumer. Barbara said it as well. At the same time, we are confronted by an absurd situation where processed low-quality foods are more affordable and available than the food we need the most to nourish sustainable development and humanity. Population growth combined with climate change will place growing stress on food systems, particularly in Africa and Asia, where there will live an additional 2 billion people by 2050. At the same time, rapidly increasing urbanization, particularly in these two regions, will affect hunger and nutrition in complex ways, both positively and negatively. So, unless decision makers are able to put the brakes on growing rates of overweight and obesity and accelerate efforts to reduce undernutrition, everyone will pay a high and heavy price. That disease, productivity losses, and degradation of the environment, also leading to increasing conflicts, poverty, and people movements in a race to the bottom. A new nutritious food era is needed to meet this challenge. Around the world, coordinated action needs to be accompanied by fundamental shifts in our understanding and in our policies. Food systems need to be repositioned from just supplying food to providing high-quality diets for all. Much more emphasis must be given to positioning agriculture and food value chains as a way to improve diet quality rather than merely delivering sufficient calories and or profit. This will require new policy initiatives and to encompass trade, the environment and health, which harness the power of the private sector and support consumers to access better diets. Decision makers must take a comprehensive, coordinated approach to transform global thinking and redesign national food systems. There's not one international food systems, but we should have the national food systems approach to make the food system sustainable and healthy, involving all relevant stakeholders, including farmers, fisher folks, and food producers, to get a fair price. And across sectors, ensuring all efforts are nutrition sensitive. The food industry has long been criticized, and still is, for its part in making food environments unhealthier. But it also has the potential to make them healthier. It is key for governments, civil society, the United Nations agencies, development partners, scientists, and the private sector to establish a common understanding of the critical role of diet quality and translating this into a food system. For this, incentives are needed to promote confidence in companies to take the necessary decisions and risks in investing in more nutritious foods. And critical dialogue is needed to ensure the wider business community will become part of the solution rather than a barrier to sustainable change. Incentivizing the production and consumption of healthy, nutritious food, which is sustainably produced, processed, transported, and disposed of, while discouraging the production and consumption of unhealthy food with a large environmental and climate footprint, is crucial. In other words, a flexible, tailor-made toolkit of policy carrots and sticks is needed to guide such a transformation. The Codex Alimentarius, or the Food Code, has helped to set food safety standards. Now we need science-based guidelines on what constitutes a healthy, nutritious diet which doesn't break the back of our planet. The upcoming Eat Lancet Commission report on healthy diets may support such new chapter of the Codex Alimentarius, a nutritious and sustainable diets code. Finally, decision makers need to encourage an open, efficient, and fair trading system, especially for agricultural goods, through reform of trade, domestic support, and investment policies to promote nutrition, health, inclusiveness, and environmental sustainability. Ladies and gentlemen, as we focus on here today, the migration food nexus also matters for all stakeholders if we are to sustainably improve our food and nutrition. In an era in which migration is increasingly at the center of the public debate and crucial to the decision-making process, much more awareness on the links between food and migration is needed. Because migration could be a powerful contributor to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals, and food security, nutrition, and sustainable agriculture is central to this. Labor migration can reduce poverty for migrants themselves, their families, and their origin and host countries. Migrant and the families benefit from increased income and knowledge, which allows them to spend more on nutritious food, access education and health services, and make investment, directly impacting sustainable goal number 1, 2, 3, and 4. For female migrants, increased economic resources can improve their autonomy and socioeconomic status, impacting Sustainable Development Goal 2 and 5. In origin countries, migration can lead to increased wages and greater economic growth through higher incomes, spending, and investment of migrant households. External financial flows, foreign direct investments, aid, and crucially, remittances from migrants remain of utmost importance for most of Africa. They rose from $11 billion in 2000 to $64.6 billion in 2016. being less volatile than development and foreign direct investments. They represent a lifeline that sustains household nutrition and food consumption, increases foreign currency reserves, and allow for investments. In the Asia-Pacific region, while about 70% of remittances are used for immediate needs such as food, shelter, and healthcare, the other 30%, over $77 billion regionally, is dedicated to building more secure and self-sustaining futures through better education, savings, and income-generating activities. Politicians need to look at policies affecting international remittances and remittances fees. They are by far too high in so many countries. To encourage this self-sustaining approach, which upholds dignity and self-dependency. The Global Compact for Migration, to be adopted in December this year, an effort by states, UN states, to work together towards a common approach to address global migration, represents a unique moment of opportunity to put the nexus between migration and food and nutrition security on the global policy agenda. While the 2030 agenda provides an ambitious framework with a strong political traction on its own, it will not be enough to achieve change. It's not about the what, it's even more about the who and the how, because the 2030 agenda is a people's agenda. People in whatever position or sector must be open to build coalitions and partnerships between countries, between cities, with development organizations and actors, with the private sector, and to identify and work on sustainable, realistic, concrete, results-oriented, viable objectives. Underpinning this must be a principled, country-owned and country-led approach. Governments should take ownership, prove credibility, and be held to account by their people. The recently initiated European Commission Expert Group on Agriculture in Africa has an opportunity to help shape this agenda with expertise, advice, and recommendations on reinforcing the EU-Africa partnership in food, nutrition, and farming, aiming to further develop and transform Africa's potential agriculture sector into a food systems approach that will spark innovation, job creation, and especially for youth, a better future and a sustainable development. However, to end malnutrition by 2030, a paradigm shift in country-to-country cooperation is also needed. Countries can and must learn from each other to make progress and apply the brakes to the malnutrition crisis. While no country has solved the food sustainability and malnutrition puzzle, countries have had different experiences and tried different solutions that can be shared with others for mutual benefit. For example, many higher income countries have battled overweight, obesity, and NCDs already for decades, while these are relatively new in most of the low and middle income countries. Conversely, many low and middle income countries have experiences of interventions to promote exclusive breastfeeding and prevent micronutrient deficiencies, which many high income countries could learn from in a context of low rates of exclusive breastfeeding and increased consumption. All stakeholders need to come to grips with the new normal of dealing with a food system that will serve people and preserve our planet at the same time. In the 2017 Sustainability Index of the Barilla Foundation, France, Japan, Germany, Spain, Sweden, Portugal, Italy, South Korea, and Hungary demonstrated strong and effectively implemented government policy on food waste and loss, agriculture-related conservation and research, and nutrition education, which is also crucial. Japan scored the highest in the nutritional challenges pillar, reflecting its leading position and high scores in the life quality and life expectancy categories, as well as a strong performance in the dietary patterns category. Such studies, very well written and very readable, demonstrate that they are already valuable experiences and lessons to share, which can transform the way that countries partner and create this nutritious and sustainable food revolution. New partnerships for sustainable development, driven by governments in the spirit of Sustainable Development Goal number 17, which are based on country ownership, mutual respect, integrity, transparency, and grounded in multi-sectoral and multi-stakeholder approaches, can comprehensively tackle malnutrition in all its forms. Last but not least, development cooperation has to be redesigned as well. Governments need to take the lead, take ownership over their own development agenda, bring the key sectors and stakeholders together, invest from their domestic budget, even if the country is poor. Investing from the domestic budget really brings change to ownership of a country, and ensure that policies, laws and legislations and institutional capacity is sustainable, inclusive and transparent in the long term. Encouraging self-organization and self-dependence will be crucial in putting the brakes on the healthy food, nutrition and climate crisis, but also on poverty and disparity. This forum provides a unique setting to sow or foster the seeds for such partnerships, acknowledging that all partners face a joint challenge and we all can and must learn from each other, and each of us must lead from where we are. Only by embracing new ways of working, breaking down our own silos, being ready to step out of our own comfort zones and into each other's shoes, leaving our logos and egos at the door, can we drive Agenda 2030 home, leaving no one behind. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gerda. Thanks indeed.